Good morning, good morning. I'm going to get my band on stage at the beginning of a service one of these days. One of these days. Good morning. Welcome to Asbury United Methodist Church. We're so happy that you're here, whether you're here in person or watching online. Let's stand together and let's worship. Promise me.
Promise maker, promise keeper, you finish what you begin. Our provision through the desert, you see it through till the end. Oh, you see it through till the end. Sing of the goodness of God. are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. Oh, I have lived in the goodness of God
all my life.
And all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Sing that again.
Worship. It looks a little bit like that old Folgers commercial that, you know, coffee is served on the starboard side. But we love you, five people over here, and we're glad you're here today. These are the abundance of caution folks over here, and we love you. To those of you who are joining us online, we are so glad that you're here. We love having our community of faith cross over all boundaries because we know that we worship a God who is good and does those things. And so my name is Dee Dee Roberts. I'm one of the pastors here at Asbury. Brother Nick Schimmer will be bringing our message a little bit later. If you're wondering about our attendance in this service, I suspect it has something to do with nine confirmands that are going to be confirmed at 11 in the sanctuary. And so people have kind of moved their attendance this morning to that. So we're expecting a full crowd at 11, and all of you are more than welcome to return for that service of worship to welcome those new members of Asbury into this great family of faith. Most of you received an email from me, and I apologize for the lateness. It kind of, I was trying to figure out, you know, things moved quickly the end of this week around our protocols for safety. Just briefly, what I asked this morning is for all of us to wear masks for a little bit longer while we are, as a staff and as trustees and lay leadership table, looking at guidelines around singing and some other things that are particular to us as a community of faith. In addition, on the back of your bulletin is a little picture. You've probably seen these when you've been out and about, but that's called a QR code. If you would please take a picture of that with your camera, either if you have a QR code scanner or just a picture, and that will bring up for you a form that you can register your attendance, and we would really appreciate that. First of all, we want to know who's here. Second of all, should anything happen, that allows us to have information for contact tracing. And that's good because now you don't have to register to come to worship anymore. Hallelujah. You can come if you wake up at 5 minutes till at 8:35 and you say, we can make it, you can make it. And we're happy for you to be here. So if you'll check that out this morning, the QR code, make sure you register your attendance. Thank you for being faithful. We will be meeting this week and announcing further guidelines, and I just wanted to reassure you of that this morning as we gathered for worship. Will you pray with me? Lord God, you are so good. It's been a long journey through this pandemic, but you have held us together, and you have poured out upon us your healing and comforting spirit. We know today as we gather that there are many who have lost friends and families, and some of us here who have suffered great loss through this time of illness and pandemic the world over. We just simply ask that as we gather today, that the spirit of your goodness would be upon us, that we would be open and joyful and able to rejoice even as we remember those who suffer loss. We pray also that as we worship today, that you would open our hearts and our minds to the leading of your Spirit, that your word might transform us, and that your grace would fill us. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now hear, if you will, this reading from Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all you nations. Shout to God with cries of joy. For the Lord Most High is awesome, the great King over all the earth. He subdued nations under us, peoples under our feet. He chose our inheritance for us, the pride of Jacob, whom he loved. God has ascended amid shouts of joy, the Lord amid the sounds of trumpets. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing to him a psalm of praise. God reigns over the nations. God is seated on his holy throne. The nobles of the nations assemble as the people of God of Abraham. For the king of the earth belongs to God. God is greatly exalted. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
I've kissed
your son for redemption, the price for my heart. Oh, and I don't have a context for that kind of love. I don't understand, I can't comprehend. All I know is I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again and again and again and again.
Spirit into our lives. It'll also be the first Sunday that we return to in-person Sunday school for adults, youth, and children. So that'll be at 10 o'clock next Sunday. So it'll be a good week to get back in the habit as we gather and study the Word together. It's also Confirmation Sunday. So it's a blessing to be up here to bring the message today as the youth leader here at the church. Launch service, you were not slighted by this. We have three or four of our confirmands on their way back right now from a Girl Scout camp out. I hope they are doing so safely so they get here for confirmation well and in one piece. But that is why we don't have a confirmation celebration, if you will, here in the launch this year. But we do have nine students that are being confirmed this morning. It is a joy and a blessing to take that journey with them. We have two of them actually here. We have Tristan and we have Paxton, who's in the back running slides. Paxton, good wave. And so so we're thankful for them. And then the rest of them will be here this morning. But we can get an amen for that, right? An amen for 9 students standing up this morning and saying, I have a choice and I choose Jesus Christ. So it's amazing. It's impressive. And next year we have 11. So that's 20 students in 2 years that are going to do that. So anyway, and I want to thank you for what you do in their lives and as you continue to pray for them. Speaking of that, before we start the message this morning, join me in a time of prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give thanks to you for this day and for this moment, for this opportunity to gather as your beloved children in this space, here in person and virtually online. God, we know that you are powerful and present among us, that through the power of the Holy Spirit, you are going to move in and through us today to continue to bless us in the uncountable ways that you always do. We thank you for your unending grace. We thank you for your unending mercy. We thank you for your unending love. We thank you for our Savior Jesus Christ. It is through him and by him that we are saved, that a door has been opened to you, and that we may have this conversation with you right now. We ask that you are with us during this message, God, that this message is your message, not mine. We give thanks to you for our confirmands, for our 9 students who are going to stand up today and claim Jesus Christ as their own. We thank you for Lily Burks. We thank you for Paxton Byers. We thank you for Claire South and Tristan Schimmer. We thank you for Georgia Hart and Kirby Odell, Aubrey O'Banion, Bella Livers, and Annabelle Conrad. We thank you for their families. We thank you for what they mean to our church. And we know now, God, the call is on us to walk with them in this spiritual journey. May we strengthen them. May we show them Christian love as they move into this next season of their life, growing to know you. We pray this morning for our church here at Asbury. We pray for those who are hurting, for those who are lost, for those who are angry, for those who are scared. We pray, God, that they will lean into your hope and love and not into the fear of the world. We pray this morning specifically for Clifford Smith, for Jesselyn Sinkhorn, for June Glazier, for Betty Hill, for Craig Cogbill, for Barbara Clark. We know, God, that you are with them and that you are working your will into their lives. We ask that your hand of peace and comfort be on them. As with anybody who is on the top of our hearts, the front of our minds, and the tips of our tongues, may you be with them. God, we pray this morning for your peace. We pray for your peace around the world. May it be your steady hand that brings people to know love and mercy towards one another. May they see that the only way to peace is through your Son, Jesus Christ. May they see that it is your love and mercy through the Son that teaches us how to truly love each other. We ask that you are with our Christian brothers and sisters around the globe this morning, those who are moving in dark spaces, in dangerous places, to bring the light of the gospel to those who most desperately need to hear it. We ask that you place a hedge of protection around them, God, that you are moving among them, strengthening them as they seek to bring hope where it is needed. We pray this morning for our country. We pray that you begin to sow the seeds of unity that our country so desperately needs as we move through and beyond the pandemic. May we see as Christians the call to love one another and what that truly means. May we look back on the last year and see what we have learned so we may move forward to glorify your name. May we love each other and not tear each other down. And lastly, God, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for all that has been done through him for us. We thank you for all that he taught us and continues to teach us today. We thank you for his miracles, for his healings, for his wisdom, We thank you for his lessons. We thank you for this ability to pray, which he taught us with the Lord's Prayer, which we will now say together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture this morning is from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. This is a beautiful prayer. As I read through this scripture this morning, I want you guys to ask yourself a very simple question. When I pray, do I pray this way? Hear now the word of God. For this reason, ever since I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, I have not stopped giving thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. That power is the same as the mighty strength he exerted when he raised Christ from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly realms, far from all, above all rule and authority, power and dominion, and every name that is invoked, not only in the present age, but in the age to come. And God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. That is an absolutely beautiful prayer. This is one of two prayers that Paul gives in the book of Ephesians, chapter 1 and chapter 3, where he is praying out of a deep love for these people. And it's clear how much he loves them, but it's important to understand some context about this letter, which makes this prayer all the more impressive. First of all, this letter, the letter to the Ephesians, is one of Paul's prison epistles. He wrote this while he was in prison in Rome, along with Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon. Okay? So he is in a place of captivity. He is in a place where he is being persecuted and held captive. Yet he continues to write and to preach and to share and to pray in a loving way towards other people. It is not Paul's circumstances that he is holding himself to. It is the freedom he has in Christ to love others. This is a lot believed by a lot of people to be a general letter. What I mean by that is it's attributed to the church in Ephesus, but it is widely believed that this was not a letter written directly to that church, that it was a general letter of love that Paul sent out that may have gone to multiple churches. Think of Paul's letters sometimes as sermons that may circulate around from church to church. It's important to understand that, and you see that in verses 15 through 16, where he says, because I have heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. It's very impersonal versus what you see in Colossians. But we know good and well, those of us that are students of the Bible, that Paul was in Ephesus. He was in Ephesus for a long time, 3 years, in fact. We know that in Acts 19. And let's just say that Paul wasn't exactly on his best behavior when he was in Ephesus. Paul was a bit of a troublemaker, not intentionally. He was bringing the true gospel, Jesus Christ, to the people. And my friends, when you take the true gospel of Jesus Christ to the people, sometimes that can cause trouble. We know that he caused a riot because he was impeding on the business of the world. Idol making and statue making was very, very profitable in Ephesians or in Ephesus. And so he cut into their business. God can sometimes be bad for secular business. So we know all of that. We know that Paul wrote from a place of persecution and oppression. We know this is a place he has been. We know that he has been there and he has caused trouble. We also know one other thing about the church in Ephesus. And you see this in the book of Revelation. Ephesus, at some point, loses their first love. As a church, they lose their first love. What is their first love? Jesus Christ. Somewhere along the way, they lose their way. And the Apostle John addresses that in the book of Revelation. This prayer I just read should be a challenge to all of us as Christians. Because I asked you to really think about it as I was reading it. What do you pray for? When you pray, what do you petition God for? What do you ask him to do in your life? It's a great challenge for all of us if our prayer does not mirror the way Paul prayed here. Because prior to this, prior to verse 15, Paul spends 11 verses unpacking all of the blessings that God has poured into our lives. I saw it written this way, and I think it's beautiful, so I want to share it with you. Paul states that God blessed us immensely, chose us unconditionally, adopted us adorningly, redeemed us graciously, forgave us completely, showed us grace lavishly, revealed his mystery wisely, granted us inheritance eternally, sealed us permanently, guaranteed our salvation personally. That is 11 moves that God made before you were ever even aware of who Jesus Christ is. He did all of this through the death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior. Here's an important thing to remember as Christians. No matter what you do, no matter how you grow in the faith, no matter what you come to know about Jesus, what you come to know about God, what you come to feel by the Holy Spirit, in every situation, God always goes first. If life is a game of chess, God always makes the first move. And in your life, God always makes the first move. Every door that's opened for you is opened by God. And so these 11 statements, these blessings that Paul is describing, is simply God creating a door for us to walk through. It's an equal opportunity proposition for all of those who come to faith in Jesus Christ. But here's the catch, and this is what's important to understand. And I pray every single day that our 9 confirmands understand this. The door is opened, but the choice to walk through it remains yours. Your choice to have a life in Christ or a life apart from Christ remains yours. An opportunity to repent before the Father, to claim the Son as your own, and be transformed by the Holy Spirit. As Methodists, we call this our moment of justification. It's this moment of realization that we can do nothing good apart from Christ, no matter how hard we try. But when we walk through that door, when we choose to walk through that door, what are we expecting from God? Here's something very, very interesting, because sometimes when we're new to the church, we're new to the faith, we can come to the church with some expectations, and there's some flawed expectations of what we want to get out of the church. Jesus makes 2 references to the church in all of his teachings. In Matthew 16, he talks about the church as all believers in any time and any place. But in Matthew 18, he talks about the church as the local congregation. Sort of like us sitting here today. It's important to understand that both of those are connected. Most of the great activity that we encounter as Christians, as we encounter as new people to the faith, exists in our little local congregation. But I want you to think of the church and the teachings here by Jesus the same way we look at the moon. When you look at the moon, you may only see half of it. You may only see a quarter of it, okay? But there is part there that you don't see, and you know what that part is? That part's still moon. We see ourselves, we see our church, we see our family, we see our confirmands, we walk with them, we love them. But there is a whole church out there that we don't see, and we are all united and connected in that love, in those blessings that God has poured into all of us. I saw some funny references I want to share with you about how sometimes we approach the church and confirmands. The two of you that are here, I want you to listen, because we all get this way sometimes. These are four great examples of how we approach the church. Sometimes we treat the church like a gas station. And I know gas station is the kind of word that makes you kind of tighten up this week. But we use it as, think of it as a gas station, a place where we come for our weekly spiritual refill, where we can just stop in, have our tank refilled, and go on our way. We think of the church sometimes as a movie theater, a place to escape, a place to come be entertained. Is the music good enough? Is the sermon good enough? You know, are the videos and the lights good enough? We want to come be entertained, and we want to leave smiling. Church can be like a drugstore for some of us. We come looking for a prescription for our pain. And lastly, it can be a big box retailer sometimes. We show up and we're looking for that all-in-one shop where we can get the best products in a clean, safe environment. Tell me about your music. What kind of children's program do you have? What kind of youth program do you have? A one-stop shop. And somewhere along the way, as we are looking for all of these things that we want, we find that we're just seeking a church that will just satisfy us and just make us happy. And we lose what we are called to do. We lose it in our life as Christians. We lose in our prayer life, which is to come together and to give glory to God. To give glory to God for the love He has shown for us through Jesus Christ. Let's never forget that that's what our church is here to do. So what should we ask for? What should we hope for as Christians? Paul lays it out beautifully in this passage. We should pray that the eyes of our hearts may be enlightened. That's a powerful statement. That's actually a reference back to the Old Testament, where you would hear the prophets talk about the eyes being darkened. It's a reference to the hearts of the people of Israel being darkened as they turn away from God. What Paul is praying for is that the eyes of our hearts were enlightened, that they're open to God's glorious grace through Jesus Christ, to see the hope that is in our calling. And I know our prayer for all of us is that those nine confirmands see the hope in their calling, that they see as they grow what God is calling them to do. But friends, I pray that as you sit here today that you find that out as well. Because the call God places in our lives is ever changing, I promise you. And when we listen, we find ourselves in places, and we find ourselves in opportunities that we never could have imagined. But we have to open ourselves up to it. That we have the riches of our inheritance in the saints. What that simply means is that we hope that we can see as Christians that we are called to love everybody. When Paul writes all the saints, I looked up the Greek word for all. Do you know what it means? It means all. That means we are called to love everybody. Not the Christians we agree with politically, not the Christians that we agree with socially or that we have dinner with on Friday nights. We are called to love everybody. No questions asked. And the last is that the power of God is available to us to live the Christian life. As we stay in tune with God and as we grow to know Christ, that power is imparted on us, imparted on us, imparted on us, and we grow and we are strengthened. I love that video that we showed at the very beginning, that tree. It took 145 years for it to reach its fullness of life. I don't care how old you are in here or online. I don't care how young you are. God still has a whole lot to show you and a whole lot to teach you. It's a lifelong endeavor. Because when we accept Jesus Christ, friends, we start at the same place. For those of you that are gardeners, you plant a bunch of plants. You may water them the same. You may feed them the same. You may care for them the same. They don't all grow at the same rate. So the question is, what happens when we find ourselves moving at a pace where someone else might be a little behind? I've got a video I want to show you real quick. Paxton, will that video pull up? Check this out. Some of you have probably seen that video. That video has millions of views on Facebook. The young man that was running, his name was Derek Redmond, and that was the 1992 Olympics in Barcelona, and he got about halfway around the track and blew out his hamstring. And for those of you that have ever suffered any kind of hamstring injury, you know that that is crippling. I get caught up in that video because I see his determination. He has one desire, no matter how many times he is down, no matter how bad he is hurting, to finish the race. And he does everything he can do to finish it on his own. For those of you that don't know about that video, the man who came over and helped him across the finish line was his dad. And I think that video speaks loudly to us as Christians. As we are growing in Christ, as we are moving in this race that we call life, far too often we try to do the race on our own. And we stumble, and we stumble, and we struggle, and we fall. And for our confirmands, they are going to go through that as well. They're going to have the ups and downs of their life. But we cannot get to where we want to go without the Father's arm around us, walking us to the finish line, guiding us through the love of Jesus Christ. One of the things I also love about that video is the guys who kept coming up and trying to get them to stop. That's like the world sometimes, guys, isn't it? When you live a life as a Christian that is not easy. If our lives as a Christian is too easy, we might be doing it wrong. There will be worldly things and worldly people that will try to knock us off our track. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing to remember. Paul's prayer is about three things. It's about faith, love, and hope. Faith is in the Lord Jesus. Faith is entrusting our lives to Jesus today. Hope is about the future, about where our present trust in Jesus eventually leads to. So I ask that you live into your faith, but you lean into the hope of God's future for you and experience God's unending, unrelenting love for you. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. As the band comes back up, I invite you to stand with me as we affirm our faith together as Christians. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
What a joy. What a joy it has been to be in worship together today. As we prepare to leave, I want to give you just a few opportunities where you can lean into that faith and live out. Wait a minute, I just got it wrong. Live your faith and lean into the hope. That's it, isn't it? I try so hard. Anyway, we've got lots of things going on this week. I remind you that next Sunday, we all come back for Sunday school and activities here in the building. What an exciting day that will be. Wear red if you can. That's a symbol of Pentecost. It's also that way we can keep track of each other better. Nobody will blend into the background. What a day of rejoicing that will be. In your five things that you received this week, the announcement that goes out in email, there was a survey there that Nicole Rose, our new Director of Children's Ministries and Family Ministries, put there, and she would really appreciate it if you would fill out that survey so that she can gather some more information as she begins to open up and build upon the strong foundation of children's ministry that we have here at Asbury United Methodist Church. And so do keep that in mind. There's one other opportunity. We've been invited to take on an extra Sunday of Stone Soup, the fifth Sunday of May, which also happens to be a holiday weekend. Greg Stanzel, who is our coordinator of that, is reaching out and asking for us to volunteer so that our neighbors who need food and need a meal can have a hot meal that day. And so if you're available on Sunday afternoon, the 30th of May, we sure would love to see you down at Quapaw Quarter. And if you could let Greg know or the church office know that you're available to help, that would be huge. And so with those things, I'm going to turn it over to Brother Nick. You have one. Okay.
You don't have to put chairs up today, but we do need a little bit of help from anybody that's able-bodied. At noon today, we're going to have a luncheon in here for the confirmands and their guests, and it's going to be about 70 people. I was hoping that some would be willing to stay after the service and set up some tables, if you guys are willing to do that. So that way, it'll be ready to go. Anyway, so if any of you are able to stay and do that, Austin is going to lead that, and he'll let you know what he needs. And if you can, thank you so much.
Yeah, and then after you do that, we've got some coffee and pastries out in the hallway. One more announcement. We just keep adding to it. Next week for our Pentecost celebration, the prison band will be here. So we've got a treat in store there. Our band is taking a much-needed break for that week. So here, receive this benediction. May the God who is able cover you with such assurance of your salvation that you will be willing to risk it all, even your very life, for the sake of Jesus Christ. And may that peace which comes only from God be yours, filling you with hope, growing your faith, and making you able to serve and create the kingdom in your midst. Go forth, my friends, as believers in Jesus our Christ. Amen.